I want to just really address two main ideas. The first main idea is that computers are something that is truly new under the sun, and they provide us with truly new ways of disseminating educational information, and that it's extremely important for us to think about what these new ways are in a research environment where we have the opportunity to think 10 years in the future. About 2 years ago, it occurred to me that something very strange is going on, and that is that a lot of the emphasis on why computers are good for you, why computers are interesting, has to do with their precision, with the fact that they help you to think analytically, that they make you think in terms of procedures, that they make you be exact. I think all of those things are extremely important. But it may turn out that the really important and interesting new use of computers has to do with something totally different. And that has to do with intuitive understanding of problems that people find it difficult to grasp. And the way that we can reach this intuitive level is with the dynamic graphics that the computers provide. Almost everything I'm going to say for the next little bit is going to be really about graphics, about pictures, how we can communicate with people via pictures. That's the other thing that's going to be different about these devices that you're going to see, and that is that the screens are different from the ones that you've seen this morning. The first film is made from a computer that has a screen that's 8.5 by 11, so it has this aspect ratio. These screens are bitmapped, and that means that every single dot can be either black or white, and we have a great many dots. We have 600 dots across this 8.5 distance here, and we have about 800 dots down this way, so that you can see that you can get very high resolution. So it's possible for us to make very fine pictures, not these big block letters that you've seen this morning on the commercially available machines, but very, very carefully drawn letters and beautiful pictures. So those are sort of the major differences. So the first film is about a system called TRIP that we did 2 years ago when I first got this idea about how intuition was going to be the important thing to think about. The idea was as follows. Lots and lots of people can do algebra in the sense of doing the mechanical part of algebra. They can move the x on the other side and divide by 2 and all those things. But they usually don't understand it very well. Even people who can do the mechanics of algebra can't do algebra word problems. Almost no one can do algebra word problems. So we view this as a translation problem. People get this English on the screen, which is the statement of the problem. And I'll show you the first problem that you're going to see so that you'll know what to look for. I'll read it to you. It says, train A left Los Angeles at 1 o'clock, going 75 miles an hour bound for San Francisco, 400 miles away. At 2 o'clock, train B left San Francisco bound for Los Angeles at 50 miles an hour. Also at 2 o'clock, a controller noticed that a switch had failed and that the two trains were on the same track. Question is, how much time did he have to prevent a collision? Now, lots and lots of students who can divide by X or something have no idea what to do with that. They can't translate it into anything that's useful to them from which they can proceed. So what we've done here is to put these relevant pictures, high-resolution pictures, of train A and train B, Los Angeles and San Francisco, down on the screen. And what we're going to have them do is pick up those pictures and move them into this area up here, which is going to be the diagram. The process is going to be to take that English and translate it into a diagram. The computer is going to know whether the diagram is correct or not. It's going to watch while the student goes through this process. Well, that's another thing that's different about this machine from the ones you've seen so far. We're not, for the most part, going to communicate with it by typing. People type badly and don't like to type and don't need to type for most of the things that we want to do. So we have a pointing device called a mouse. It's called a mouse because it looks faintly like a mouse. It's a little thing like this that rolls around on the table as you push it with your hand. It has a cord coming out of it that leads to the computer, which looks like a mouse's tail. As the student moves this device around on the table, the movement is reflected on this computer screen in the form of what we call a cursor. Often it looks like an arrow that's pointing at the place that the student wants to indicate. So the student is going to communicate with this screen, this 8.5 by 11 screen, by moving this mouse on the table. And as he does, a pointing device is going to show up. Then the mouse has 3 buttons on it, which the student can push. If he pushes the first button, it says, "Select this picture." Thereafter, that picture will follow the mouse wherever the student goes. You will see all this in the film, but I want you to understand what's making it move. So the student can pick up these pictures and paste them down in this diagram. There is a little bit of typing because we're going to have to say something about 400 miles and 2 o'clock and 1 o'clock. We will type in those numbers. The student will type in those numbers. But most of this stuff is done with pointing. These big areas down here are what we call soft buttons on the screen. We have a very large help button. And in this particular program, there is a very large help system. So anytime the student doesn't know what to do, he just presses with the mouse this button. And the button fills with text and tells him what is next expected. This is, of course, a quit button. The gripe button causes the whole screen to turn white so that it turns into a giant page into which the student can type as much complaining or approbation as he likes. The check button up there is pressed whenever the student wants the diagram checked. And as you watch the film unfold, you'll see that the buttons change. That's why they're called soft buttons. Sometimes that check button will say guess, sometimes it will say run, and sometimes something else. So those are soft buttons that change as the conditions change. Well, one more word about this before we see the film. The first part of this is to translate from the English to a diagram. The system knows whether the diagram is correct. When it's correct, it makes these pictures go away down here, as they're no longer needed, and starts to build what's called a guess table. Students in this particular class, and I must say that this has been pilot tested, this system called TRIP was pilot tested in a remedial math class at San Francisco State University. And the students in that class were led to solve these problems by estimating. It was the technique that was used by the teachers in the class long before the computer showed up. So once they have their diagram correct, their next task is to estimate the right answer, and they're encouraged to do that just roughly without worrying about it too much. Then they can actually run this diagram. It will turn into an animated simulation of the problem. And that's where we want to reach this notion of intuitive grasp, that they can have some intuition about the meaning of D equals RT, which is something they all know but none of them understands. By watching this diagram move, they will see that one train moves more rapidly than the other, and they will see various dials, which aren't visible on this slide, moving as well. Yeah, I will just put up this slide to remind you that our intentions were to explore new uses of interactive graphics, especially as in regard to intuition, and to provide a totally self-explanatory system. When the system was tested, it was put in a math lab just standing alone with no teacher and no instructions except a one-page handout that told the student how to use the mouse, what the three buttons on the mouse were for, and how to put the disk in and out of the machine. This was run on an experimental computer called an Alto, which is not for sale, and which had a large hard disk that the student would have to insert and then remove when the student was done. So that one page just told them how to do the mouse and how to put the disk in and out of the machine. The rest of everything about how to make this problem go is in the help button. And you will see that illustrated in the film. These are the features that were provided for the student, that they can move those pictures around, that the diagram can be checked whenever they like, and when the diagram is correct, they can actually run that simulation, and then it has this very large help system. So I think now we should run that first tape, and I'll tell you about it as it unfolds. These are titles that we made using the computer, called this thing, Closely Watch Trains and Boats and Planes. And you can see these travelers moving around on the screen, and bunnies, too. These are all time rate distance problems. And as you can see, some of them are overtake problems. This one's an overtake problem. Some of them are collision problems. This is just a set of titles for myself from the Xerox Palo Alto Research Center, and for William Finzer, who's a very fine teacher at San Francisco State University, and for Joan Differding, who is a high school student who made all the beautiful pictures that you're going to see. This is Joan pretending to be one of our students in our research lab. That's the housing of the screen. You can see the mouse and the keyboard. The system is saying, welcome to TRIP, please type in your name. And so she's typing in Joan. And it's speaking to her about this week's problem. We did 8 homework problems as a pilot test, and so it would always tell about the nature of this week's problem. And she's choosing the top one, which is the one I've already read to you about train A and train B. And now you're watching what she would be watching as the problem starts to be painted on the screen. The pictures are being found. This program is actually a kit that's capable of running any sort of time rate distance problem. So the system is rummaging around finding the appropriate pictures. Now you can see the cursor moving across the top as she's just using it as a pointing device for reading. So she's reading about train B left Los Angeles and so on. And at 1 o'clock, she's just using that cursor to read with. Notice it looks like an arrow. When the system is busy, it will look like a star. And at other times, it will take on other shapes. So she's shaking her head over this thing and pushing the help button. It says, please start by picking up a traveler and putting it down in the diagram. And if you don't know how, please consult the documentation to tell how to use the mouse. And if you still don't know how, go and ask somebody. So here's a close-up now so that you can see the high-resolution graphics. She's just pointing at that train, and now you see it following her cursor until she places it where she wants on the left-hand side of the tracks. What the system will do now is to construct what we call a travel table, because there's important information about this train that we have to make in our translation. One is what time it starts, and another important thing is how fast it's going. She doesn't know how to use that thing, so she pushed the help button, and it says a travel table has been provided, and so please edit the values in that table to suit the values that are shown in the problem. So she now will use the second mouse button. She will press it. The cursor reads, now type. You probably can't see it, but it changes to read the little letters, now type. And she's typed in 1 o'clock for train A. And now she's typing in 75, which is the rate that train A was going. And notice that the needle on the speedometer is being set, another intuitive thing to enforce the idea that this is 75 miles an hour. She pushed the check button to see if her diagram was correct, and it said, this is a problem about two travelers. Please put another traveler in your diagram. So the system is watching while she builds this diagram, knows what's the most important thing to do next. And so she's put up train B, and just as with train A, a travel table is being built, and she now has to go and edit this table to reflect what it says in the problem. So it says, now type. She's typing in 2 for 2 o'clock. And now she's going to type in the rate for train B. And she typed in 60, and the needle will be set appropriately. And she's going to go up and push this check button again to see how she's doing. And I think that says that you should please change the rate of one of your travelers to correspond to the rate shown in the problem. So she's going to look up now back at the problem, read it again. You can see this close-up of the mouse. She's going to read it and find out that it didn't say 60, it said 50. And now she's changed that to be correct. And she's going to check her problem again. And this one says, your travelers are not the right distance apart. This is a collision problem, and in this particular situation, the distance between the travelers is very important. So there is a little icon at the top of the diagram that represents the distance between the two endpoints, that one. And again, we always leave something in there so it's not empty for the student to edit. And she's going to type in 400. That's the distance from Los Angeles to San Francisco. And check her diagram again. And the help system says, please put up a place in your diagram for your traveler to start from. Now, this is obviously nothing that's going to help her with her algebra. Really doesn't matter whether she puts pictures of San Francisco and Los Angeles, unless you believe that an intuitive picture will help her. So this is a teacher option. As the teachers describe these problems to the system, they can specify to some extent what they'd like the checker to look for. So now she's pressed the check button, and the help system is saying, your diagram looks fine. Now it's time to answer the question by making a guess. And you do that by editing the guess table that appears beneath the travel table. Teachers at San Francisco State have taught the students that one way to approach these problems is to solve them by estimating. So now Joan is going to make a rough guess of how long it will be before train B collides with train A. She's typed in 2 for 2 hours. And now she doesn't know what to do, so she's pressing the help button. And the help system is saying, now that you've made your guess, you can run the problem whenever you like by selecting run. Now notice the check button has gone away. There is now a run button. Notice also that new instrumentation is being built by the system, an independent clock and odometer for each traveler, and a real clock set to 1 o'clock, which is the time of departure of train A. And now the trains are starting to run, at least train A is, and the dials are running, and when it gets to be 2 o'clock, there goes train B. So the trains are running towards each other, all the clocks are running, and it stops. Well, it stops when she said it will be 2 hours that train B will run before it crashes into train A. So the system is running that for 2 hours of simulated time and stopping. And now it's built all these extra boxes in this guest table and is asking her to fill them out. So what's happened here is she's made an hypothesis. Supposing it's 2 hours, and what she's doing now is recording the results, except she put something in the wrong box, so the help system here is saying, you've put the wrong type of thing in the box, please fix that up. So here she's now doing it again, and it's all done again by just pointing in the way that she picked up the trains and pointed at them and moved them around. So she's making a permanent record here of the results of her guess. This is the effect of her guess. This last box over here says A plus B odometer, because that's an important part of this problem. And she's trying to edit that to put in the right value, and the system won't let her edit it. It wants her to pick something up and put it in there. So that makes her angry. So here's an illustration of the gripe thing. It takes the whole screen, gives you a full page, suggests that you complain as much as you would like. And she's saying, I don't see why I can't edit the empty box. It seems perfectly reasonable to me. That all gets recorded. We keep a complete transcript of everything that the student does, which can be read by the teacher or even read by a machine to be analyzed. And embedded in that complete transcript are all of the student complaints. So now what she's going to do is what the system wanted, which is to pick up any old odometer and use it as a template and then edit it. So she's put in 325 as the sum of those two odometers. And then she's going to proceed to make another guess, because it's clear that 2 hours, which she guessed, was not enough. And but the system won't let her go on. It says train A trips time is wrong. So she's somehow, when she filled in that table, put the wrong thing in the box. The system will not let her proceed until every entry in that guess table is correct, because that's important data for her that she's going to need to do her algebra with. Well, and now she's making another guess. It was clear that 2 hours was not enough, so she's going to guess something more. All of our students guessed in the right direction. Having made a guess that was too large or too small, they would always make the next guess in the right direction.